So let us start our discussion about intelligent method of learning. So what I'm going to do, I will go through my slides, which I showed you yesterday, and try to explain everything, not from the point of view of technicalities, but from the point of view of pure ideas. And I would like to show how these ideas working without, say, deep technicalities. The content of the talk, that there exist many mechanisms of learning, different mechanisms of learning. There is a core mechanism, which we discovered, say, in between 65 and 75. And this core mechanism guarantees convergence, guarantees consistency. So if you will use standard structural risk minimization principle, you will converge always to Bayesian solution, so no problem. So if you have a ton of data, you just do formally whatever you have to do mathematically, and you will be happy with your goal. But in reality, all business of learning is that you would like to have this rule fast. Fast means using small number of examples. When I will talk about fast, it means not computationally fast. It means number of examples, but computationally can be intense. It does not matter. We hope that it will be better computer or more computers. I'm talking only about number of examples. And I call it accelerating mechanism. And unexpectedly, we realize that teacher is object which accelerate your training data. From formal point of view, you don't need teacher at all. You have formal mathematical mechanism, and you have, if you have tons of examples, you will be okay with training whatever you're doing. But if you would like to train fast, you should play tricks which teacher playing. So we was able to discover a couple of tricks which I will discuss during my talk. What is that, and maybe in philosophical words, what it means. But I believe that there is much more mechanisms. And when we're talking about what theory of pattern recognition should do, theory of pattern recognition should discover what teacher does. I should say that in psychology department, in pedagogical department, people don't know that. So now pattern recognition, it is not only science about computers, it is also science about human being, how human learn, what tricks teacher does, because it is unexpected tricks even for psychologists. And that is second accelerating mechanism. And recently, this year, we discovered maybe the most powerful, which we don't understand yet, and I will talk about this mechanism a lot, synergy mechanism. Synergy mechanism, it is sort of gift of gods, because I will come to that. And it can improve learning a lot and can reduce number of examples a lot. At the end of the talk, I will be even argue that it does not exist a problem of big data. So if you're training smart, if you're using accelerating mechanism, maybe instead of many data, you can use many different rules and combine in them in synergy matter. We will see this, I will discuss. But these three big categories, the core mechanism and accelerating mechanism and synergy mechanism, it's what we know now. But till this year, we did not understand machine learning community that there are many mechanisms. And the main problem, as I understand, it is future discovery of mechanism of learning. So if we will talk metaphorically, now we're trying to construct some instrument. and we have to play on this instrument. It is two different specialities. Say, I consider my specialty to construct instrument, like if I great, like Guarneri, Amati, Stradivarius, but there are great player, which is different specialty. They can play even on the bad violins very well, like say, Oistrakh, like Paganini, like great violinists. So it is two different specialties, and we should not mix them. So maybe we can discuss when we will discuss about deep learning, to what specialty it belong. Is it belong to specialty of creating tool, of creating instrument, or have to play some instrument? Okay. I started my presentation with perceptron and also mentioned that it was 50 years ago. Since this 50 years, not a lot of guys left who start from very beginning. Here it is Ilya Muchnik, Schlesinger, Mikhail, and me, and myself. The rest is new guy. So you don't know all the jumps and down in developing of machine learning. It was several great ideas, which metaphorically say comes from God, and several great failures, which come say from devil. And of course, the main problem how to distinguish between God and devil. Say, 50 years ago, great guy, Eugene Wigner, wrote article called Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in Natural Science. He argued that when you're looking in mathematics, you can discover in the formalities, in formal mathematics, in high-level mathematics, some models of nature, which you cannot see when you're trying to observe nature, you cannot capture them. It just comes from formalities. It looks like mathematics something knows about real world. And he wrote this Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in Natural Science. After him, the same, under the same title, was written many articles, Unreasonable Mathematics in Biology, Unreasonable in Geology, and so on. So my goal is today explain as Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in Machine Learning. But I start with perceptron. It was great invention, because it has two great properties. First property, it very good suited mathematically. And because it very well suited mathematically, it has some way for generalization. And also it is very well suited for theoretical analysis. And I will talk about both of them. So let me, in my presentation, I will talk about first generalization, neural network. Which is combination, you know, of many neurons. One neuron constructs separating hyperplane. It is McCulloch and Pitts model. Let's consider the simplest model. Don't go in technicalities. So, but if you consider many McCulloch and Pitts neurons constructing network, you will have a piecewise linear function. From mathematical point of view, saying neural networks is wrong. It is engineering point of view. How you constructing something? From mathematical point of view, you should say, I will estimate my function among set of piecewise linear function. And that is only way how I will do it on my computers. I will do it this way, but I will show you different way using kernel how you can do the same story with multi-layer perceptron, with piecewise linear generalization. But second generalization is transformation into Hilbert space. I forgot to tell you that when we're talking about God's ideas, which is bright ideas, a devil ideas, they have some characteristics. So Einstein wrote about God, subtle the Lord, but malicious he is not. So it's my idea that God idea is very, very smart, very unexpected. And when you're trying to distinguish between God and devil, you should distinguish between smart and not so smart. But when I trying to understand what is the idea of devil. And in the past 50 years, I just saw one idea of devil, brute force idea. So from this point of view, when we will discuss deep learning, when we will discuss big data, it have some flavor of brute force. And would like to have, if we will have discussion, so it should be discussion how you have a feeling about nature, where is brute force, and is it necessary brute force, or we should looking for some smart ideas. And that will be main subject of my discussion. I will not talk about technicalities, about expected loss, empirical loss. You know, it is just for mathematical formalization. There is a theorem about uniform convergence. I discussed this yesterday. I gave some main theorems, which the first is most important, that you need not just law of large numbers, but uniform law of large numbers. You have VC dimension and you have all this stuff. So it looks like a complicated theory. But let me come to my comments and show that it is almost trivial. I would like to come to time of Shannon, when he introduced information theory at Comets. So how theory information started? From which observation? Shannon observed that if you have n examples, n things, and you would like to find among n one, how many questions you can ask Curie to find one, the smallest amount of questions you have to ask Curie to find this object among n objects. But Curie can answer only yes or not. Okay, so you can, the answer is logarithm n. And it is very simple, you can split your object on two parts, on first part and second part, and then ask Curie, is object which I interested in the first part? Curie can say yes or not. If he say yes, you remove second part. If he say not, you remove first part. And then you have again a number of object, but twice less, and you repeat the same trick. So after n tricks, you will have one object, and you're happy with that, you will find. You cannot do faster, because you must split into parts. Otherwise, if you're unlucky, you will need more questions than log n. So it is the smallest number which guarantees that. So let's come to pattern recognition. I would like to say that pattern recognition, it is exactly question which asked Shannon. For example, we have n binary functions, and we would like to find the one binary function, one n function, which, say, classify our example perfectly. What I can do, I can split my set of functions. I can try to find x, some vector x, which splits my set of functions on two categories. On one category which answer one, and second category of function which answer yes. And then you can ask Curie, what is y for this x? And Curie will say me, one or zero, I again will remove one part and do that. And again, log n is exactly the way what is that. It is very simple, and what I want to do, the foundation of information theory and pattern recognition is the same. But in pattern recognition, we a little bit more tricky. We say it is very difficult to find the point X which split exactly function on two part. So do something easy. Okay, I will use L randomly choosing according to some probability measure point X, and we'll try to find function which perfectly agree with this. And the rest, the function which will left from removing of function which disagree with answer of query on the set, I can pick up any of them and declare that that is function which I'm looking for. And pattern recognition theory answers the number of questions I should ask is, again, logarithm n over epsilon. And epsilon, it is epsilon closeness of function which I pick up to the best possible one. It is trivial theorem, but it is the first theorem which we observed in pattern recognition 50 years ago. Just it is, you have optimality, logarithm n, but constant factor, 1 over epsilon. But you can say, okay, let's do more complicated story. In the set of functions, there are no functions which can which can perfectly separate my data. Yes, I fine. I will do the same job. I will consider x points, and then I will choose function which gives smallest number of errors on this training data, and pick up one function with smallest number of errors. And how many examples I need? Again, logarithm n, and again, constant factor, x epsilon square instead of, in denominators instead of epsilon. But then you say, okay, in reality, I would like to have infinite number of functions and pick up one from infinite. Okay, very good. You can do that, but this is so-called big theory, but in reality, this theory, what it does, it replaces log n with VC dimension. And if you will go in detail, that VC dimension, construction of VC dimension is logarithm of number of possible separation. And you have again, when you have this answer, the number which, when you have perfectly separating VC dimension over epsilon, or VC dimension over epsilon square. And the bound cannot be improved. So you have the same structure, like structure of which introduced Shannon, but in more complete way. So when everything is started, I recalling a remark of Kolmogorov, who says that in our real life, we have three categories of numbers. You have real number which we use every day, say, count our money or whatever. It can be from 1 to 10,000, to 100,000, to million, but reasonable number which we can. Then we have numbers, say, which we can choose from. It is 2 to the real number, 2 to the, if, yeah. If real number is n, it is first category, n. Then second category, 2 to the n. This number, it is number of rules which you can consider. It is whatever, but we have third category of numbers, say 2 to the 2 to the n. And he told that this number is out of our reach. We can do nothing. And you can understand why, because with this number, Shannon information gives you, if you have n-bit information, you can choose, but you cannot expect that you will have 2 to the n-bit information. But maybe you can. But that is the open question, and maybe we will discuss this question as well. But what I would like to say, let us forget about all technicalities with infinite number of functions, with a dimension, with all this stuff. But core problem, you have n function, n is some from 2 to the n function, so big number of functions. And you would like to choose one from this function. And that is the core problem. And Shannon told that if you have log n bit information, then you can do that. Okay. Let me come back to my lectures, and I will continue our discussion. This is all these bounds, and if you will take a look at HSVC dimension, that this bound exactly coincides with Shannon bound, and that is the most interesting part, that in all your improvement of bounds, you're improving constant, you're never improving log n. And the same question remains up to now, is it Kolmogorov right that this number is out of our reach, or we can construct something that reaches this number? We don't know yet. And what was great in the theory, which in VC theory, and that I want you to understand, that if you have structure with bounded VC dimension, with elements where VC dimension is bounded, so that is VC dimension for lambda 1, VC dimension for lambda set, and then you're trying to minimize your function over structure, because you have a structure, you're choosing element of structure, and over function of inside of element of structure. This is structure risk minimization. You can converge to any function of coverage. That means that given set of function, construct structure, and in most cases, you will converge to whatever you're looking for. That is just solving problem of pattern recognition. Do structural risk minimization and forget about everything. Well, I claim that all algorithms which you're inventing and was invented before, if they're smart, they contain two things. First, they're trying to minimize number of training error. It is impossible to imagine that you have algorithm where number of training error is large, but test error is small. But also you're looking for capacity or complexity of your decision rule. And that is structural risk minimization. But it does not formulate how it can be done. It can be done in all possible ways. So I like way of support vector machines. And I will argue that unreasonable effectiveness of models and all these tricks, all this mechanism which we found because of support vector machines. We're looking carefully what support vector machine does, and suddenly I'll jump and can see from formulas a new mechanism which appeared. And I will show you why. So let's come back to Shannon story. If you have n function, you need log n bit information to find one function from that. But you need it only because your query gives you one bit information. You're asking him a question about what is this x, and he says 0 or 1. But what we can do, if your query will give you more than one bit information, then you probably can do better constant times. If, say, query will give you 10 bit information, so you can learn 10 times faster because you, or formally, so you can expect that you can utilize this 10-bit information and do 10 times faster. But what it means? It means that you have, so what you formally have, what usually when you have X, teacher, according to some conditional generator, y given x, generate 0 or 1. That is what teacher does. But now, and y can be 0 or 1, that's 1-bit information. So we can say, so if we would like to do faster, teacher should generate more than 1-bit information. So what means I want generator P, Y, comma, X star, which is additional, 1-bit from that, and this is additional information, given X. And that then, if people generate this, you will have XY, comma, XY star, and YY. You have privileged information. So privileged information comes just directly from Shannon, because you cannot do better than log N. If you want to do better than log N, it is like conservation law in physics. You should give more than 1-bit information. And more than 1-bit information give X star. So, and I consider X star in different form. It can be some one value, it can be say vector, it can be whatever it can be. But it's something conditionally to 1-bit of information. And when we consider path recognition problem from very beginning, I talk about slack variables. I have this picture, and I consider Curie, who gives me slack Oracle SVM. What Oracle SVM does, it gives triplet X, Xi, and Y. Xi is slacks. And then I show that mathematically that if you have slacks, if you have extra, you can converge faster. But also, instead of 1 over logarithm n or VC dimension over epsilon square, you will have VC dimension over epsilon. Huge difference. But you still would like to have a more. But then I introduce model where you're simultaneously trying to estimate slack function and decision function. So I will skip technicality, how to do it in kernel space, but main idea is that I would like to estimate simultaneously two functions, because teacher gave me this new information about slack. I would like to estimate slack from his XY. So in technicality, it is in equation, then you're trying to solve this equation, blah, 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 and you came to this to this form. And then for the first time, when we obtain this, we take a close look what support vector does, and how complicated is the solution. You have kernel, and this kernel comes in the first line and in the second line. And they play different roles in the first line and in the second line. In the first line, it's just function of expansion. You're trying to expand your rule over some function. So you have kernel of two variables, you fix value of one variable, that means you fix some function and have, say, first function for expansion. Then you fix second and so on. So you have expansion over this set of functions.
We cannot see. If you use the mouse, we can see what you mean. When you use your finger, we don't see.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So that is expansion, because you're fixing something, and you have series like that, and you have coefficient. To estimate coefficient, you have to use this equation. So for support vector machine, you don't have whatever written in blue. This is written for privileged information, for the additional. But whatever written in blue, it has kernel play different role over here. Kernel describe how close
But to do this, we need to have a k-star kernel is a polynomial, not polynomial, positive defined kernel.
Right, right. Because you any kernel you want, you mapping what you're doing. I explained yesterday. You mapping x in zeta space, in Hilbert space, and x star in different Hilbert space, zeta star space.
But to solve quadratic dual quadratic program, we should have a positive defined kernel.
Yeah, but when the word of mapping in different space means that inner product defined by positive, that's it. So it is equivalent to mapping. So you have two positive definite, that is for mapping in one space. But I want to pay attention only that kernel play some sort of different roles in this equation. In the first line, it describes how expand the function. On the second line, how close element xy to xj. It could be contradictory. So when Chef Taylor yesterday explained, we discussed with him how to choose kernel. It have to achieve compromise between two different roles that playing kernel. Now when you introduce privileged information, you have second kernel, which will not go to expansion because it will not be known for test data. You don't need it. For test data, you want only expansion on the first kernel. But here it is similarity control. So teacher, what does teacher? Teacher try to explain that example X and example Y have this similarity. Not whatever you will have from this kernel here, but you should change your similarity in the way as I will do. So what it means? It means that for some reason, student understands that this example close to that. But when teacher teach you in another space, saying something about in different language, he told me, no. This is closer to this object than to that object. And then you have two descriptions of similarity. On one language, which is one language is technical language, and then second language, which is teacher language. It can be every language, any language you want. Because on the bottom line, you need only distance between how similar one example to another example. It can be emotional, it can be whatever fantasy. I will show you something, what's going on. And that's what we understood from SVM, from this equation, that one of the goal of teacher to change your concept of similarity. Because from technical point of view, it is one concept of similarity and from another. I have a friend who study how to play golf. And his coach, when he teach him, he explained, don't hit the ball, seduce the ball. And every time when he hits the ball, you're doing something wrong, you're seducing like macho. Or when he hit in another way, he say, you're seducing, you don't know what you want to do. So, but what it means? It means that if you have XY, which is like macho, and XJ, which you don't know what you have to do, it has some sort of similarity in this language which student understand. But here, you should explain similarity, say, velocity of your movement, angle of your hand, angle of your legs, and something like that. In this description, similarity is one. In description of teacher, don't hit the balls, it's similarity. So my friend told me that in a couple of days, he understands perfectly what he do. And when teacher use this word, it is easy to understand how to behave then when if he will explain you how to play, which is velocity you should do, how to what is position of your hand, of the leg, and so on. But those of you who study music or something else, they see that the teachers never explain play louder or play slowly. He makes some metaphoric sentences. And student at the stat is much better than that. That's why. That is similarity control, which student does. But we're not talking what space. Have teacher inventing this mapping. This is a real generator of intelligence for every X to give pair Y and X star. Y it is class, it is not too intelligent. But X star, metaphoric, something which you mapping in different space. This is which will play a role of similarity control. This is real intelligent. Maybe at the end of talk I will talk what I think is intelligence. I don't think that it is so simple. I don't think that it is so formal like, say, what we d- yeah.
But you know k of x star I and x star j, it would be enough for you.
Will be enough. Mm. But teacher cannot tell you that.
But just similar, this too similar. This it is just input data, which pairs are similar.
It's not enough because the matrix x y x j must be positive definite. You cannot give numbers and guarantee that it will be positive definite. You must give xy and xj. And even you're using kernel, it will be positive definite. So teacher not so smart to give you value such that it will not contradict all your examples.
I disagree. Let me just trivial trick. I say just subjectively, these pairs are similar. If I have this information for everything, I know a vector of my similarities and no vector for another the vectors, and I compare them Euclidean. It would be the objective from originally. I give you data which is not the positive defined, but finally I transform to positive defined.
No, if you have a good kernel, if you just give me a number, so if you will say, XY kernel XY XJ it is 5, and another kernel it is 7, and he gives you these numbers. How you can guarantee that if you will make a matrix, it will be matrix positive definite?
This matrix would be not positive.
No, it could not be positive. You need all these tricks, this kernel, to keep matrix positive definite. So you cannot avoid this. And what is the great that you can understand all this business with similarity control only from equation. First we obtain equation and then we understood what it does. Yeah.
So you were comparing this to metaphorical reasoning, and to me it feels like metaphorical reasoning is trying to connect sort of one world of knowledge to something maybe that you understand that or that you have learned somewhere else. So it feels a bit like it should have something to do with transfer of knowledge.
Yeah,
and
I will
don't
talk
quite
about,
understand it this way.
Right, it is second trick. I will talk about this special, but it is two different mechanisms. It is mechanism number one, and I will talk about mechanism number two, where transfer knowledge in from one space to another space. But for time being, I'm talking about first mechanism, which called similarity control. Teacher, so what I know about teacher, but I believe that maybe teacher has more mechanism. I know about teacher that teacher used two mechanisms. One is similarity control, and second is knowledge transfer. I will talk about knowledge transfer, which.
I have one question here. I think I sort of understood what Professor Michnik said earlier. So if you look at your x and x star, you put them together as a new vector. You concatenate these two features.
Oh, yeah.
Then rather than having these two terms, you could simply have similarity.
You will obtain nonsense. Because on the test data, you will not have x star.
Oh, you don't have that. OK. That's the reason. Thank you.
OK. So let me switch again to application to show you what means similarity, second space. So I told in my presentation about, say, separation of biological objects with three-dimensional case and so for and sequences, but I would like to show something else. For example, I would like to show future events like privileged information. What is that? Suppose I would like to predict I observing black crosses, and would like to predict what's happened in the red crosses time. So. Say I would like to predict stock value. Is it in week will be higher or lower? So higher is first class. Should what I should do, sell or buy stocks? So people usually use this and then in time series predict that. But I can do the following. I can use this and like privileged information to have green crosses. Afterward. You would say, okay, for test data, I don't have that. That's absolutely true. But you have historical data. And historical data, you have this. So that is privileged information, and you can play with this information to get better performance. Okay, so what it means? So when you're doing regression, say everything is known. It is linear regression, normal noise, and linear regression exists. That very simple. Where is the best prediction you will have? The worst prediction you will have by the end, because variance will be bigger to the ends. But in the middle, you will have small variance. So you have expectation and small variance, so it is good to do something in the middle. And that's exactly this example. And I should say that it is interesting, but in time series prediction, people never considered future event like instrument to improve time series prediction. It just came from thinking about machine learning and what can be done. And that is half it.
Could I ask, so if you include the label itself in privileged information, I'm sure it becomes completely useless, if not just this neighborhood, but you also add the data you're predicting.
No, it is just example to explain about future events.
Yes, but what makes privileged information useful? Why is it so your neighborhood
Because when you consider similarity, it's similarity not only about previous observation, but also about future observation. So you take into account, when you're trying to explain to your student behavior of time series, say, You probably would say, okay, it's behaving like that, and then here you would like to predict, you will continue to draw your picture, and that's exactly what's going on. So you have this privileged information. And that is example that privileged information, one step ahead, five step ahead, eight step ahead, because it is, some artificial example, we can have a lot of data. We have Bayesian rule, and Bayesian rule at SVM for 10,000, it probably will converge. And we have Oracle SVM when we can know the slugs and try, and it is yellow. And blue is SVM, and red is SVM with privileged information, systematically improved. But this is the most important example, and I would like to discuss it. Suppose you would like to just do separate 5 from 8. That is easy problem, so you say resize, make it more difficult. It is second row. But I have friend, had friend, she passed away, and ask, she was professor of Russian poetry in Moscow University. And I ask for every digit to express your feeling in poetical way. What is that? What is feeling? What can be? And that what she see, this picture 5, which you have on the left corner, straightforward, very active, hard, very muscular, with rather clear intention, sportsman of war, no, and blah, 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 40 years old. No, no, that is just impression about that. And impression about 8, a young man, energetic, and seriously absorbed in his career. He is not absolutely precise and accurate, and blah, 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 blah. Okay, that is their feeling. We don't understand that because it is, so we ask, make a code for that. And that is called active, passive, feminine, masculine, hard, soft, blah, blah, blah. And even with this code, we will be not able to make a code because we don't understand what's the meaning about that. And she did it, this code. And then we train. And that is privileged information, this poetic description. And that's what we got. This blue is SVM. This is Oracle SVM because we have a lot of digit we can construct slugs, and we can do the best what can be done. The best what can be done, it is slugs, because and that is in the middle. So this is for 40 observations, 60 and so on. Why it is important? It is important because teacher explanation is mostly looks like nonsense. It is metaphoric, but it is not. It is not nonsense. It is way to express similarity in different language. You can use, I ask her, in two languages, in poetic languages, and there is the Yin-Yang, Chinese culture language. And we have also description in Yin-Yang. And I was surprised when we got about the same result, but on it is a different story. But I will come again, that role of second kernel, it just express similarity, it does not matter language which you're using. It can be emotional, it can be, say, whatever you want, musical, picture, you can do whatever you want. You just, it is way to express like how it's similar.
She gave different descriptions for each example? Or just for two, like categories, 5 and 8?
No, she gave, we gave her 100 examples, 58 and 55, and she wrote 100 poems.
I see.
Yeah.
For the same different file.
So let me switch because of question of Bernard to knowledge transfer. This is knowledge transfer mechanism. What is that? Teacher gives you triplets, X, X star, and Y. And as I told you, from point of view of Shannon, If you would like to have a small data, you need more than one bit information, you need it x star. But as soon as you have triplets, x, x star, and y, you have two problems of pattern recognition. One problem in x space, and another problem in x star space, because you have pair x1, y1, and you have pair x star 1, y1, and all this. So you have two different rules. One rule in one space and another rule in another space. And of course, teacher trying to create language where he can do a good job to separate whatever he wants to separate using this language. And suppose there exists a rule, again, SVM rule, which is linear combination of kernel in X star space. You know this rule, and you would like transfer this null. You have data, but also you have a rule, and you would like to transfer this rule in X space. Well, so this is very good example what it means. Suppose your goal is biopsy analysis, cancer from non-cancer. And you have picture. On the pixel space, you have picture, and that you would like to looking on the picture and make a decision. But also, your expert gives report on this picture. And in report, it can be written aggressive proliferation of cell of type A into cell of type B, or he can the absence of any dynamic and standard picture, blah, 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 whatever language using this guy for description. And that is very remain poetic description. In different word, in different space, you're describing and you will try to have similarity in this language, in description of in high level description. So couple of words about second language. Why we hope that the rule in the higher level space will be better than if you will construct rule in the initial space? The answer is following, that the rule when we construct in high level space, we're trying to construct language in this space. And it is scientific language. Scientific language does not contain extras. So it developed just for some problem. And say, when you will consider VC dimension of the set of function in this space, it will be much smaller than VC dimension in initial space. Say, in pixel space, you can distinguish cancer from non-cancer, and also you can distinguish nice girl of Italian origin from nice girl of Spanish origin. So you have to have a huge set of function to do that, and you should pay price for that. It is log n. It is the VC dimension high. But when you're constructing scientific language, you're trying to do it precise, and precise means low VC dimension. So that means that if you're doing correctly, so you hope that you will have a very good decision rule in high dimensional space. At least invention of this language is related to this goal. Well, now let's talk about knowledge representation. In artificial intelligence, there is a concept how to represent knowledge. It is Minsky concept, it's not my concept. First of all, you should have fundamental element of knowledge in X space. That's first element, I will talk about that. Then you should have main frames or fragments of the knowledge in X star space. That's the second. What Minsky consider. And number three, structure of knowledge. Structure of knowledge combination. Structure of knowledge. It is combination for fragment for frames. So when you have, say, your function, you have, say, x, y, and the smallest number of x, y, which the smallest number of support vectors, say, it is fundamental concept of knowledge. Then you have frame of knowledge. It is function of expansion. And you have structure, which is linear. So everything in support vector machine is exist. So what you now want, you would like to transfer frame, this function, into space X. If you will be able to do that, then you transfer knowledge of frame in high-level space to the feature of low-level space. So, and if you do it perfectly, you can use the same coefficients. If you don't do it perfectly, you can train again on the second part of the space. So you have transformation from high level to space to low level space. And that is second trick which can play teacher. Teacher explain knowledge without saying this decision rule. Just describing, just using language. And this have to transfer knowledge, it's just technicality. You can do regression function using all this stuff. And that is how powerful this idea of knowledge transfer. So Rauf used it for drones, which have to capture some objects on the field. So real drones can should fly fast and to look in the wide area simultaneously. But it is difficult to find object if you have such type of picture. But then you can have additional information which goes back and forth, say like privileged information. You're moving slowly on the same field and many times, and with camera with good resolution. So if you will train in the SVM, you will have that. If you will train in, say, slow moving object, you will have smaller rate of convergence. But if you will transfer, you will have red. So you can decrease more than two times the error just transferring knowledge from the high-level space to another level space. So that's the tricks which I know that teacher playing with privileged information. But I'm sure that there are more tricks, and it will be great to discover them, not only from the point of view of pattern recognition, because these examples give a big advantage of intelligent learning comparing to just brute force learning, just statistics. But I don't know. And I try talk to psychologists, they know nothing about that. So that means that the goal of machine learning to understand humans, to understand, and this is very particular case, what teacher does. And we don't understand what teacher does here when he's talking nonsense and all this stuff. And that is, from my point of view, we know not a lot about that. We just find this maybe this year, maybe last half a year, we did something, which synergy of decision rules. And to talk about synergy of decision rule, we need to talk about foundation of statistics. So, foundation, two great guys developed statistics. One of those, Ronald Fisher, who created just applied statistics. Everything which we're doing now, it was made by Fisher. But he completely ignored theoretical mathematical stuff of whatever going on. And the second great guy was Andrei Kolmogorov, who tried to step by step introduce rigorous statistical science. And it was done in the 30s. And the main concept which people have in statistics is cumulative distribution function. And people trying to estimate cumulative distribution function using empirical cumulative distribution function. And that is empirical cumulative. It's just step functions. And the main theorem of statistics says that empirical distribution function converge to real distribution function fast. And this is the rate of convergence, which is really good for finite number of observations exponential. And the same for multidimensional case. Empirical distribution function you can construct for that as empirical distribution function. And you have the same bound, so nothing wrong going on with empirical distribution function in multidimensional case. And now your goal to estimate conditional probability or conditional density or regression, it is the same. This is definition of conditional probability. If you multiply both left-hand side and right-hand side of P of X, and then take an integral, you will have this function. For conditional density function and conditional density function. Let's talk about more simple things. Conditional probability function, probability of Y given class, say, first. Probability of first class given X, which is probability of first class comma X divided by probability of the X. So this definition and integral equation is completely the same because it is written in different language. I just take an integral from 0 to X and then that is that. But why this is good? Because the only object which converge to real cumulative distribution function is empirical distribution function. And you can replace real cumulative distribution function with empirical distribution function. And when you're doing that, you will have this problem, say, for regression function, the same problem for conditional probability function. And you need to solve this equation and have Ralph show you when you're solving this equation, you will. So when you're solving this equation, when you will put instead of real cumulative distribution function, empirical distribution function, you will have instead of a real operator, this empirical operator. Instead of right-hand side, this expression. And when you're trying to solve using regularization method, you will have this solution. So when you will do that, just formally, when you will make a sum accurately and integrate it accurately, nothing to do, just make this distance. Just compute this distance, you will obtain some, say, V matrix. And that is what makes difference between least square method and the method which comes from rigorous analysis. I would say that it was impossible till 65, maybe later, this rigorous analysis, because solution of Ilpost problems was not known till 65. In 65, Tikhonov for the first time introduced all this stuff. And then it will be possible to rewrite statistics like solution of ill post problem. And it so happens that we did it for the first time. And I show you last time that there is a big difference between least square method and accurate method, which comes from solution of ill post problem, which you have to do. Because when you're coming back and try to understand why least square method, who introduced least square method, and how it justified, it was introduced by Gauss just because he needs some computing. And it was not justified. People try to find condition when least square method is good. They found some condition when it good for unbiased estimation. But for bias, it never was justified. But this is something which is different. And you can formally have a different, say, least square method, the different expression for least square method and for in kernels, in support vector machine, and for V-matrix method. And this illustration, which I told you, and then Rawls today stressed, that the difference, it is in the sense that V-matrix produces not only better closeness to real solution, but also producing smooth function. And this is gift of gods, of monotonic function. So let me give you definition of monotonic function in probability. The function is monotonic in probability if probability of y given 1 of the first class for function fx bigger than probability f for first class for f from x star if f of x more bigger than f of x star. So think about support vector machine. If you have support vector machine, first class should be positive, second class negative. If you have positive 0.1 for one example, and for another example, positive 0.5, you believe that probability that gives 0.5 is probability that point of the first class for 0.5 is bigger than probability. That is monotonic function. But when you're trying to use monotonic function, it's happened something very amusing. Because if you're trying to solve your equation in the set of monotonic function, the problem stopped to be ill post. Because why problem ill post, I try to explain, because you have overfitting, you have oscillation, but for monotonic function, you don't have oscillation. So when you're estimating something in monotonic function, you can do much better solving equations than. So now, when I have two scores, say two rules solving the same problem, I can try not to do ensemble, like people usually doing in machine learning, but to do synergy, to construct conditional probability for monotonic function in the case when I say using SVM because it gives monotonic solutions. And and this is example why synergy is monotonic function is matter. It just describe that it has no oscillation. And then there are many problems, almost on the any step you can do synergy. So we just choose from this set of problems, the problems which contain a lot of test examples. We won't like to check if we have advantage or have disadvantage. We should have a reliable value. So this is the best what we can achieve on support vector machines. And this is the synergy. We took two actually. What we did, we took two support vector machines. One which used kernel splines, and another radial basis function. Two different kernels which solve the same problem using the same training data. And that's what can be done, this line using spline, this line using RBF, and at the end, what can be done when you're using synergy. And you can see always it is better, and sometime it is much better, much, much better. For example, for adults, it's about 3% of advantage, and for diabetes, it's about 4% of advantage. So synergy, it's very strong. That, then I would like to ask how much example you have to add to push support vector machine to decrease on 3%. It is huge amount of examples. So when I talk in beginning that maybe big data, it is not appropriate approach. So I thought about synergy. So maybe instead of big data, we can do many different monotonic rules and take a synergy of them. And they will give approximately the same story. And the last, and this is geometry of what's going on. I will skip this. And the last is we don't know how to solve multi-class classification problem. Any solution of multi-class classification problem, now it is heuristic. So what when we use one versus the rest, we also can try to classify using synergy mechanism, because we can say what is probability that y equal to class number k if we have score for one versus the rest, two versus the rest, if you have all scores simultaneously, and try to find the maximum of them. Huge difference, more than 3.5, more than 3%. So what is intelligent learning? So in fact, learning contains many mechanisms. It just what we're doing now, it is core mechanism, it is brute force mechanism, just asymptotic mechanism which converges to Bayesian solution. But there is actually acceleration mechanism, which is comes from directly from Shannon theory information. You must to add some bit of information to accelerate you. And that is privileged information. And then you can play two games, to similarity control and to knowledge transfer. And the most important, I believe, but we don't know a lot of stuff about that because we know about just last half a year, it is synergy mechanism. It is not ensemble. It is only due to fact of monotonic rules, of monotonic solution. Special property. You're solving your ill-posed problem in class of function which does not allow oscillation. And that gives you synergy. I believe that we must to look on new mechanisms, not only these three, and not only on teacher, but also what can be else. And that is like instrument. So you can combine any approach with that. You can start with synergy, you can continue with synergy. It looks like in machine learning, we have two specialties. One specialty is guys who create tools, like say, Rauf and me, say, trying to find what the mechanism behind that. But another completely different mechanism, different specialty, is try to use this instrument to play well. It's like violin. You can have a good violin, but bad player, and you have can have a, say, not too good violin, but great player, and it will play great. But it is different specialties. So my impression about deep learning. I think that deep learning guys, it is guys from second specialty. They can play something, but they don't understand mechanism behind that. They have intuition how to do that. And everything what they're doing, they call deep learning. I think that from my point of view, it's not very good because you prevent from the core task of machine learning, from discovery of mechanisms, from what is not machine learning, but human learning, what is human intelligence. And all this stuff. And there is a very funny questions which which left. What is intelligent generator? So I talking about that exists intelligent generator, which generate y, it is 0, 1, it is again, and also x, given x star. And there is a contradiction. If we assume that intelligent generation only inside of our brain, it will contradict to Shannon. In the closed environment, you can generate information. To generate information, environment should be open. So my guess is to come back to the old discussion, is consciousness is just only inside of us, but also outside of us? That is open question, and maybe it is most important question for human being. But here, we can try to prove something from machine learning. Is it possible to generate information inside just one brain? Or you should be we should be connected each other in some way, I don't know what is the way, but that is the sort of questions which you should ask, which achieve I don't like word machine learning, say learning, or maybe machine learning, but human also machine. So I finished this. And if you have a question, it's not too tired, I will answer you.
Somebody would like to tell something, not only questions.
Yeah.
We have time.
Okay, thank you very much. But with this privileged information, it looks like that you don't need data at all. Because if you know, if you have a good teacher, then you should show examples.
You're not right. If I have X star, what I can do? Okay. I can create in the space of X star, but I need decision rule in space of X, not in space of X star.
But you can calculate, nevertheless, minimize everything. No.
It is your suggestion. Please do your research. Okay. My claim that it is impossible.
Okay.
Because you have to use two pattern recognition problems.
Yeah.
One pattern recognition for one space, another pattern recognition for another space.
Yes.
And transfer knowledge from one space to another space. Or you can play a different trick. You can say, change concept of similarity in your student. Student believes that this example close to this, but you have to explain him somehow that no, this is not so close to that one. But it is not so simple because it should be positive definite matrix. It requires some mathematics.
The next lecture should be recognition without patterns.
No, it is your fantasy.
Okay.
Just continue in this way, and you will have a nonsense. Just try to understand. You know what I want you. Try to understand what I tell you. There is a sense in what I tell you. And there is examples. And so cheap tricks like training without examples, it's not work.
Yeah,
Yes, in one of the earlier slides, you show knowledge transfer,
yeah,
where the similarity in X star space can come to help with the similarity in X space, which I don't see. No,
knowledge transfer is different. It nothing to do to with similarity. It is second mechanism.
Okay, so I want to see mathematically how you can move on to another.
I will show yeah, exactly that. What is that about.
Not this one, earlier.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, this one.
So, oh, no, no, yeah. Let's start from beginning. Yeah. What you have triplets, right? You have these triplets. From these triplets, you can see, you can construct two path recognition problem. One path recognition problem from one space, and another path recognition problem from another space. Suppose your teacher is smart. He creates smart second space, a scientific space, which have low VC dimension, and then means that you need small number of examples to construct rule. You're constructing this rule. And then you have these examples, and also you have this rule. And you would like to transfer knowledge about this rule in different space to your decision space. How you can do that?
So I don't know how the fee is computed from there.
How come that? Yeah. That is how it comes. You construct examples over there. You know, it is better if you will read article because it is technicality. It is a regression problem, straightforward regression problem between two spaces. Okay. It can be solved using SVM.
Okay.
And an explanation is why it is good to transfer knowledge in high space. Because you're transferring not whole knowledge, you're transferring frame of the knowledge, part of the knowledge. So here you have frames.
I see. So that approximation.
Yeah. You're transferring many pieces of knowledge.
Okay.
And that is smaller than knowledge at whole, which you would like to construct in this space. Okay. So after that, you transfer this. You can use it like teacher. You can do it whatever you want to do. But you have something, some knowledge, some frames of knowledge transformed in this space, and then linear combination remain, and you can get it.
Okay. And the approximation is close enough that you can claim that in X space you can get better.
That is example. Okay. We just did here we did almost three times less.
So when I saw your original problem there, one is classified in X space, the other one is X star space.
That's X space. Thus, green is X star space,
okay, so
this is transfer knowledge.
So I thought that you can do synergy between these two classifiers to get better.
No. Synergy is different mechanism. So you know that there are many mechanisms, and they are different. So when you're creating your decision rule, you can play different strategy. You can play, say, brute force strategy. You can combine brute force strategy with teacher, which is with privileged information, or it is gift of gods synergy. So you can just do synergy. And the question about synergy, is it possible always to attack big data problem? Is there exist necessity in big data problem? Or you can make some set of decision rule and make synergy of them. It's an open question.
Yeah, of course. I have another question about big data. So I sort of disagree with your comments about big data because all the mechanism you show there is that if the small data, you actually can speed up your convergence. Therefore, you don't need to have big data. But in practice, in many problems, big data give you diversity of the information.
That's what
if
you're thinking.
You are just, you know, garbage in, garbage out.
No, it is. I understand. That is old point of view. But let me show you some example, which was for us extremely amusing result, experimental result, which I'm not so fast to find.
Yeah, big data covers the, you know, the big space, so that in the test environment, hopefully it get covered. But if it was small data, it may not cover whatever condition under which your test condition
so
has.
So here it is very interesting story. You have one ink spline and another RBF spline. Yeah. They use the same training data. Yeah. And then construct two different rules.
Yeah. Okay.
What is correlation between these rules? Here, where we have 3% improvement, correlation over 95%.
Yeah.
What it means? That there exists something trivial,
yeah,
which comes in all rules,
yeah,
and that gives you correlation.
Yeah.
But when you're trying to understand what is the difference, you have this is synergy rule. So this is one rule, green another rule, but this gives synergy rule.
Synergy rule.
So, yeah. So maybe mechanism completely yeah different. That you have, from small data, yeah, you have something which is common in all classifiers.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you have something which is different for specific classifier, yeah, which does not come in this.
Yeah.
But you see
yeah, okay,
everywhere correlation yeah is yeah high. And this is 1995. Coefficient correlation, and we still have advantage.
Yeah, yeah. For the example, you don't have the problem I mentioned.
Yeah, yeah. So how far it can go? We check only two rule for synergy, but formally you can do as many rule as you want. And my question here, okay, I got 70%. People who using say neural net or SVM, how much data you should increase to drop down to on 3%. It is tons of data you need.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so for neural net, people actually just, you know, simulate the data more and more. And just the opposite to what you said.
No,
you
no,
get
no
more data, like MNIST, for example, they do
no
distortion.
No, I understand.
And
when
you
have,
get much better error.
Right? It is your problem.
Yeah.
But when the difficulties of problem uh-huh is how many data you need, to do rule. That is another story, and that is the main story.
Yeah, like the image, right? So if
how many examples
image, I mean, you image should... Image drop down to 5%, for example.
No, no. How many examples you have to show to kid to teach him? And then it's synergy.
Yeah, yeah.
And another question, why when you study from several teachers, it is better? It
yeah
is synergy.
Yeah.
So yeah everywhere in human learning is synergy.
Okay. Thank you.
So, but I'm sure that it's not only a mechanism.
I've got a couple of non-serious, simple-minded questions on metaphorical level to hit up the ongoing discussion. First, do you consider, for example, the genetical biological evolution a brute force approach?
No, I don't know. I hate to speculate. I hate to invent something. I following Wigner's idea, look in mathematics,
okay,
and it will show you mechanisms.
This was
I'm not so smart to invent mechanisms. I don't believe in inventors. That is my personal feeling.
Okay.
I think that people cannot invent something. They're inventing something very primitive. You recall,
I mean, biological evolution is not invented by people, but it was not a serious.
You believe in that how it written in textbook, it is so happened. But who knows? I am not specialist in biological evolution. I will not.
Okay.
Say
the second simple-minded, unserious, metaphorical question is: do you rather believe that humans have somewhere deep in their mind buried this gift of God in terms of SVM, and they can, like SVM, they can, for example, learn to Bayesian level of inference, or they have some not Stradivari-like instrument they have to live with.
I don't know what's in the human brain. And for me, it doesn't matter. Because for me, it matters what is in mathematics. Because I believe, I'm not believe in people who saying, I know what is in human brain.
Yeah, of course.
So I don't know if human brain is isolated from universe or not. That was my last question.
But
so I am ready to accept hypothesis that human brain not isolated.
Okay.
It is universal brain.
You're just drawing parallels between the issues you observe, the ideas you observe on the humans, and so this was an inspired question. And then less of a simple-minded question: could this privileged information come from some other learning algorithm, like some other approach? We just will train some other classifier and use its predictions as privileged information.
You're asking me, what is source of intelligence?
I mean, could this source of intelligence?
Who's the source of it? I don't know. Maybe universe.
No.
Please don't
mix the previous simple-minded questions with this deeply just technical question. We have this X star. What if we didn't you try to feed as X star as privileged information the results of the predictions by other trained classifiers from different approaches from not SVM let's say. Okay.
No, it should be different space. But you know my advice, you just read this article. It is published. It is completely different point of view, where you have two different spaces, and you interact between these spaces.
Yeah, I guess.
It is very old philosophy that there exists the world of things and world of ideas. And people discuss this a lot of interactions between that. But try to understand, not try to take new approach and describe in all terms. It is new approach, it is new ideas.
I guess I understand that.
I am sure that you don't understand it. 100% sure.
I guess you don't understand my question.
I don't understand your question. I agree.
Well, let's postpone.
I don't want to understand this question.
Can I ask my question? it's more particular. Imagine that you have like random privileged information, just like you generated it. So would this algorithm, I mean the accelerated learning, then be like suboptimal, worse than?
No. I don't know how appeared privileged information. My guess is that it is intelligent generator. I can say nothing about it, intelligent generator. So for me, the highest level of intelligence in this coach, which says, don't hit the ball, seduce the ball. How he created these metaphors? How he understood that on this language can be described something? That is intelligence, not brute force, which you work like computer, your brain works like computer. It is not intelligence. Intelligence is this one. How to generate new metaphors, how to generate second level, which is good enough for that. So if you will generate something random, of course you will have nothing. I think that teacher is not idiot. When he talking you nonsense, he has something behind that. Or he trying to control your concept of similarity, or he trying to transfer his knowledge in your space, but he does something. And so, I can say nothing about brain of.
No, my question would like kind of different. Can there be kind of mathematical threshold for the amount of information in this privileged information, right? Which is required for this algorithm to be better than standard SVM? Like that it should be stronger than something otherwise it would be suboptimal that you spend like more...
I don't know in which term you want to have it.
Yeah, it's quite hard, but I mean like that it should be...
No, I can tell you. So you have two spaces. So the rule which you would like to have, say, let's talk about pixel space and description of biopsy in high-level scientific space. So all information you have, it is in pixel space. The best rule God can construct, it is in pixel space. In this high-level space, in scientific space, you can construct maybe rule not much worse than in pixel space, because you're required to do in pixel space. But your goal is to construct such description of scientific language that VC dimension on this level will be smaller than VC dimension of low level, where you can do everything. So because your language is specialized for solving this problem, you can do something. But I don't know how people invented this language. But it exists. And my question is this development of intelligent is just inside of our brain, or it also outside of the brain?
Yeah. You presented a very, very attractive picture of some kind of dialogue between one vector space and another vector space. It even reminds me the structure of human brain, like half right hemisphere and left hemisphere. It's very, very interesting. But thinking about efficient structures, educational structure, I know, it normally comprised of three levels, a student, an instructor, and a teacher. And normally, teacher talks to an instructor to a student, and meanwhile, we have this direct interaction between the teacher and the student. So my question is, it worth considering three vector space structure of...
You know, I consider several teachers and synergy between several teachers. That I understand. But three level, I don't understand model. I don't understand what's happened in this model. Maybe if you will work, you can develop something like that. But in my picture, I cannot see three level. I see only two levels.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I have one related question here. So looking at your problem formulation, X star is available in the training set, but not in the test set.
Yeah.
And to me, I mean, maybe that's my old thinking. It's more like a latent variable problem. I have X observed, I have Y, you know, available that I observed in the training. Now I have X star, which is observed in the training, but not in the test. Therefore, I treat that problem as a missing data problem. So there's a huge of mathematical formalism, like Bayesian, framework getting solved the problem.
It will not work.
It's not going to work. Explain to me why it doesn't work. Yeah. It's the same problem.
No. Because the problem not that it's not the same. Because missing data you have, that it is related to the same statistics. If it's not related to the same statistics, it's useless.
I see. Okay.
This is two different statistics. It's one space, another space. It's two different spaces. You cannot compare apple and oranges.
Thank you.
Okay, please.
So it is my guess. I don't know.
And that is the reason why we don't know whether this privileged information comes from our brain or from somewhere else. Can you be slightly more formal about that?
No. It is like second law of thermodynamics.
Okay.
Because entropy and information, it has the same flavor. It's just my guess because there is a second law of thermodynamics.
Okay, but how can I know whether the world where the recognition engine lives is closed or open?
I don't know, it is guess. Because a lot of people saying that, maybe you can explain. No, because I don't know Eastern philosophy, but there are a lot of philosophers who thinking like that. Even more, I will tell. If you will talk to poets, so some of them believe that they take dictation. And another belief that they're working to improve something which is on the higher level. And they believe in that. So they have feeling of connection. The better poet, the more evidence he will give you that he take dictation or he trying to improve something.
I didn't mean to be so esoteric, but in robotics there is a theory in philosophy of robotics of embodiment, which says that robots can become intelligent only because they have body and interact with the environment.
You know, forget about philosophers. Because they don't know mathematics. Even Popper, Karl Popper, you know who is that?
Yes.
It is highest. So he made mistake in philosophy.
I was in several European projects based on this philosophical paradigm. There was big money in those projects. And
yeah, I think that philosophers does not know what they're talking about because world is so much complicated with machine learning. Say, Popper almost came to VC, to definition of VC dimension, but made mistake. It is the smartest from philosophers. He claims that the simplest function is sine, but sine has an infinite VC dimension.
So I have one last philosophical question here. So in your example of drone image, right, and high resolution image is your X, and low resolution image is your X star. The one you talk about.
No.
Vice. Oh, the other one.
Otherwise.
Okay. So now in that application, I know in training set you can have both. Now in the test set you can have both as well. So
In test set you have only one.
I mean, you could have both, right? You can have both. Then probably much simpler.
then somebody will kill your drone because you have to fly slowly.
Oh, okay, I got it. Okay. So for the experiment. Okay, good. Thank you.
One question, Ed, at the end of your talk, you mentioned both a contrast between your approach and deep learning, and together with that, you also had a sort of priority established, which you said that the core purpose of machine learning was a discovery of mechanism. And so I guess my question is sort of an open-ended to you, but it's how much of the difference in philosophy and approach between you and maybe someone in deep learning is owing to a different objective, a different priority, maybe.
I have a question for you. Do you know what is deep learning?
I'm familiar with a body of techniques that are described as deep learning.
It is huge neural net, right? It is not mathematical definition. It is engineering. Nobody knows, nobody can give definition what is deep learning. Some people say, I will do first this, then that, then this, and that, and I call this deep learning. Okay, It is smart engineering. From very beginning, I told that there are two specialties. People who try to understand what is learning about, and people who have a good skill to solve problems. And that is different specialties, like in violin. One created good violin, like Stradivari, and another is great player, but cannot create violin, like say Paganini. It is two different things. But then comes mixture. Say engineering concept like neural net mixed with mathematical concept. Mathematical concept is very simple. It is piecewise linear function. That's it. But engineering concept I constructed like that. And yeah, I will do this, this and that. So I believe that people have a great result. But not because they understand essence of learning, but because they can play violin well. like, say, Jan Likunis. Great engineer, he can do that.
Thank you.
But even in his article, he tried to explain that it is cult. Cargo cult science. In his explanation, what is deep learning? Cargo cult, so I imitate something. I don't understand, but I am imitate. It is not science. You just imitate something. Science starts when you're trying to understand what's going on, not how it's going on. It's two different questions, what's going on and how it's going on. So in deep learning, it is how it's going on. Oh, I believe the brain doing that, and I will imitate this and call this deep learning. But I don't buy this. I would like to understand what's going on, what mechanism, because we can invent, maybe exist, maybe you can discover. It is reality. And so why it is not only about machine, it is about humans as well. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. Well, if you consider this a two-edge scenarios, like let's say the generator of X star results in a zero-length X star, what will be the how do you interpret that? And the other question I have.
No, let's first question. I don't understand well, first question. You're asking something about this generator.
Yeah, I mean, the X star, if you end up seeing that the teacher doesn't see any kind of missing thing as a
no,
result.
For me, teacher, it is greatest intellectual because he generates something. He generates information. How he generates, I don't know. It is greatness of teacher.
Basically, the definition of teacher implies that there should always be X star that is of length bigger than zero, like vector length bigger than zero, i.e. one
no, X. No, I don't know. I know that if you want from Shannon perspective, to have more than one bit information, and Y gives only one bit information, mm-hmm. you should add something else, and that is X, mm-hmm. and that is privileged information, only during training.
So if this...
Zero length, you get classical SPM.
Yeah, I know, but I was meaning, what was the interpretation of that, but apparently that's not within the scope of this. But the other thing that I was wondering is, if we say that we've got a fairly large sample size, and that helps us be able to learn a more complex model.
So there is a theorem which says, if you have tons of data, use structural risk minimization and you will have Bayesian solution. Don't worry about that.
But if asymptotically think that we're going for larger sample sizes and we've got a reflection of the knowledge that generates X star, and use that to expand X, in both train and test data.
No. When you extend X using X star, you will have elements of X star during test set.
No, what I mean is, at the step zero, when we want to start the process, let's say Oracle SVM versus normal SVM, we say we're going to do normal SVM. We've got, luckily, a bigger data set, and also we've got some extra information that means we can expand to X on both train and test. So in that case, can expansion of the future
that.
Engineering...
No, it is pure model what mechanism exists. Of course, from engineering point of view, you can play with these different games and construct many algorithms. So, but from conceptual point of view, it's interesting which rules, which principles you should to have mm-hmm. to combine from. And that is what I'm talking.
Okay.
I'm not on the level of engineering. And I tell several times that people from engineering department can do better than people who discover this because they can combine, they have feeling for that. So in deep learning, probably I surprised how they got this results. They have a feeling, I don't know how. But it is not science.
Vladimir Ramovich, after you developed a theoretical basis for the brute force, The next step, you try to go further and to understand what additional information must be used. The next step was transductive learning. Second step, privileged learning. What might be the next step?
I don't
My
know.
Hypothesis mm-hmm. is that you can consider a sequence of enlarging spaces, x star, x two stars, three stars, etc. Because a learning system is functioning in open space when a teacher also can become more and more clever. Teacher
yeah,
also learns.
I agree with you and I consider this scheme. But you know, it is more engineering scheme than, say, scientific scheme. So I consider that. But it does not, at least whatever in my analysis, it did not come with new mechanism when you have several steps. It just iterates the same mechanism on different level. So, thank you.